There is something that's quite amazing, Sean, in the book of Zechariah.
Oh, yeah. I was hoping we would get there.
You know, it talks about a group of people in heaven, and you may want to read it for us, that come up to Jesus. And as they come up to Jesus, they see that Jesus has nails in his hands. And these people are in heaven. And they say to him, "Master, where did you get the prints in your hands?"
Well, yeah, I've looked it up. It's in Zechariah 13, verse 6. And this is a moving
verse. It really is.
I've actually highlighted this in my Bible because it spoke volumes to me. "And one shall say unto him, What are these wounds in your hands? Then he shall answer, Those with which I was wounded in the house of my friends." That's remarkable. Here's somebody who meets Jesus, sees the wounds in his hands, and has no idea how he got them.
Right. Now, Sean, the logical question that is asked is, if what we have said indeed is true, and I believe it is biblically, why then does the church, the Christian church, so passionately do missionary work and reach out to save people in evangelism if it is possible that God knows the background of the person? My response to that would be this. We reach out to share Jesus, not to give people their first chance or their only chance, but to give them their best chance. The best possibility of being saved in God's kingdom is to hear the story of love in the Gospels.
Right.
Because that breaks your heart. There is a revelation of God in nature. There is a revelation of God around us. There are people whose hearts are drawn out to God that never knew the name of Christ. But we want to give them the very best opportunity because when you look at nature, it gives mixed messages. There's the rose, but then there are the thorns on the rose. There is the sun that warms my body, but there's the sun that scorches the plants.
It gives you a sunburn.
Yeah, right. Yeah. There's the wind that gives me a gentle breeze, but also the hurricanes that tear apart my house. In the universe, there's good and evil.
Yes.
But when we look at Scripture, we see the reason for that controversy between good and evil, and we see Jesus plunging himself into it as Savior. So the reason we do evangelism is to give people the best opportunity to know Jesus so they can have the greatest possibility of being saved. But again, if God chooses to save people without them directly hearing, because he knows what's in their heart and he knows the honesty and the integrity and he knows that they'd respond, I have to leave that with God.
In the end, Mark, why would a loving God not bring somebody to heaven? Why is it that some people won't be there?
Because of their conscious choices. You see, if God brought all humanity to heaven with the carnal natures and the carnal hearts that we have, it would simply perpetuate the sin problem and it would continue. The only other option that God would have if he didn't bring people up there like they are today would perform cosmic surgery on their mind so that they would not ever be able to sin. And if God was going to do that, why didn't he do that thousands and thousands of years ago? Why did he make human beings with the capacity to choose if he is going to reverse that capacity of choice at the end of time and put them in a mindset so it was impossible for them to sin? So the reason he wouldn't bring somebody to heaven is because they haven't responded to the claims of his love. They haven't responded to his graciousness. They haven't allowed this living Christ to forgive their sins and to change them inside. They haven't made that choice to follow the way of love. They've made that choice to follow the way of selfishness. And that is a way of self-destruct.
Actually, somebody who was following the way of selfishness would never be happy in a place like heaven.
They would be absolutely miserable.
It would be hell for them.
You know, I saw a cartoon once on this very topic, and it was marvelous. In one page, the cartoonist showed heaven. And in heaven, there were these figures, and everything looked wonderful about them, except they had robotic arms that they could not bend. And the banquet of the heavenly table was spread with luscious fruits and nuts and baked goods. It was so fantastic. And this man was taking it, but he couldn't get it to his mouth, and it was heaven. So he was feeding the guy across the table.
Selflessness.
And people were happy, they were cheerful, then it showed hell. The exact same scene. And the arms were stiff, the food was on the table. And the guy had it like this, but he could never get it to his mouth. And they were cursing and swearing and so angry.
It's beautiful.
The way of love is the way of selfless, kind living that provides life. Jesus on the cross gave himself away so we could have eternal life. And when we give ourselves away, we not only we find life. We give ourselves to Jesus. We allow Him to live in our hearts. But the way of selfishness, the way of self-centered living, the way of egotism is death. You asked earlier, Sean, what is salvation? Salvation is coming to Jesus, allowing Him to forgive your sin, allowing Him to change your life, and living a self-sacrificing, kind, compassionate life in a world of selfishness.
Thank you, Mark. In a world where the concept of moral relativity has shackled our ability to call some things right and other things wrong, it's become unpopular to suggest that some people might be, well, wrong. And yet, simple reason tells us everybody can't be right. In any other field like math or physics, we know some things are true and other things are false. And there's no emotional baggage attached to that kind of judgment. Because when we say that 2 plus 2 cannot possibly equal 17, it doesn't have moral implications. It doesn't require somebody to change the way they live. But when Jesus says, "No one comes to the Father but by me," that demands a response from the human heart. As God in human flesh, Jesus positioned Himself as the only key to heaven. Without the divine link He provides between God and man, there is no eternity for the human race. You know, most people's reluctance to accept Jesus really comes from a reluctance to take an honest look at their own lives. Many of the world's philosophies don't demand the kind of radical change of heart spoken of in the Bible. And so many people simply take the path of least resistance, and they turn to alternative religions. But is it possible that the broad path really does lead to destruction? And is it possible that many people avoid dealing with Jesus because of a profound misunderstanding of how He intends to deal with them? Years of religious rhetoric have given some people the idea that God delights in destroying sinners. But the truth is that He delights in destroying sin while saving the sinner. So today, as Jesus speaks to your heart, He's not pointing how much He'd like to destroy you. He's signaling you. He's asking you to come for forgiveness. "Come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest," Jesus says. "For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light, and you shall find rest unto your souls." Do you long for rest? Do you crave peace of mind? Then come, says Jesus. You know, I think you'll be delighted with what you find. You know, Pastor Mark, somebody today is wrestling with how they're going to come to Jesus. They're looking for a sense of direction. What would you say to them?
Sean, that's a vital question. And I'm sure that there is somebody watching today, that you are reaching out to this Christ. Recognize that He loves you with an incredible love, that you are so valuable to Him, that you're so important to Him, that you're not a speck of cosmic dust blowing in the breeze. And to really come to this Christ is as simple as ABC. Accept that you've disobeyed Him. Accept that you've fallen from His grace. Accept that you cannot save yourself. Believe that Jesus Christ on Calvary's cross died the death you should have died. He took your place there. Confess your sin to Him and decide that you want to serve Him forever. You see, He invites you to come. He invites you to come just as you are and be saved by His marvelous, infinite mercy and grace and love. Would you like to do that right now as we pray? Dear Father in heaven, we accept today that we are sinners, that it's not possible for us to save ourselves, but we believe that Jesus Christ is a mighty Savior. Amen. We believe that He did for us what we could never do for ourselves. He gave His life on a cross called Calvary. We tearfully and sorrowfully confess our sins, and we decide to serve You forever and ever, believing that right now You're removing the guilt, believing that at this instant You're forgiving us, believing at this instant mercy and grace flows from the throne of God. I pray for that one person, Lord, that right now has their head bowed in front of their television, that right now is kneeling. Oh, my Father, be with them and give them the sense that they're a new man, a new woman, forgiven with the gift of salvation in their heart through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.